next speaker is Dave Merritt, known to all of you. He's at King's Park and Panic Garden, where he heads the Seed Science Group. Dave and I have worked for many years together on a whole range of topics. And Dave's topic today is on a very good segue following your talk, Ben, which is on dormancy and beyond. So thank you very much, Dave.
Okay, thanks very much, Kingsley. So, yeah, thanks for the invitation also to present today. I'd like to talk to you about coastal seas and really focus a little bit on the biology and adaptation that they have, some of the really quite remarkable adaptations they have to surviving and thriving in harsh environments, particularly in the coast. And sorry, I'll try and speak up a little. And for those of you who work in coastal restoration, I do apologise, the title slide is some seedlings of a horrible weed, Retama ratam or white broom, but I do like this photo to illustrate, I guess, the theme of my talk, which is kind of the remarkable toughness that these seeds have. So these seeds, you know, that they can survive in the soil probably for many decades, but you combine that toughness with this really fine-tuned sensing of the environment, and these seeds have germinated at precisely the time that's going to maximise the chances of these the seedlings surviving. So seeds, you know, they're really quite remarkable. I've been studying for a long time, and I guess the more I study them, of course, like most scientists, the more I realise I don't know, but you know, I do come to appreciate just that adaptation and how they are able to sense the environment. So we're going to be talking about germination and dormancy and a little bit about the environment in which they grow in the coast. And we'll move quickly beyond this. I guess most of you know the basic ingredients to get the seeds to germinate. They need some water, the temperature needs to be appropriate, light or dark, depending on the type of seed, and sufficient oxygen. So these are the basic ingredients, but very often, in fact, when you're working with seeds of native species, you find that you put them in conditions that are suitable for germinate and they sit there and do nothing. And so that's really what dormancy is about. And to understand dormancy properly, we have to think a little bit carefully about it. There's lots of definitions, a little bit of contention around, but this is kind of the definition that I like. And two key points are, it's an internal condition of the seed, so nothing to do with the outside. The seed is controlling its own destiny. And again, it's about how the seed senses that environment. And the important point is that dormancy prevents germination even though the conditions are suitable. And so that's a little bit hard to get your head around, but basically it stops germination during these transient periods when the conditions aren't suitable. Stops germination during transient conditions, periods when conditions are suitable, but it's the wrong time of year. So a good way to think about it, in the southwest we get our seeds falling off the plants in November, December, so spring and summer. Occasionally we get a summer rain shower, the day might be cooler, it might be wet. If the seed's thought, good time to germinate now because it's cool and wet, clearly they're not going to survive. So although the conditions are suitable for that day or two, if they actually germinated, there's no chance of the seedling surviving. So that's really what dormancy is about, is controlling that seasonal timing of germination and preventing the seeds from germinating at the wrong time of year, even if the conditions are okay to seed at that time. So to work that out, basically seeds are always sensing the environment. They're particularly reading temperature and moisture. They read the light, they read other cues that might indicate a disturbance in the environment. Smoke is a big one in our environment. And basically, many seeds, when they're in the soil, are kind of cycling through dormancy and non-dormancy. And this is kind of a classic diagram of that. So when the seeds fall off the plant, commonly they're dormant up here, so they won't germinate under any set of environmental conditions. Over time, while they're reading the environment, they'll go through this kind of cycle, so they'll become what we call conditionally dormant, so they might germinate under a very narrow set of conditions, so perhaps really optimal conditions. As they gradually continue to lose dormancy, they'll become down here, fully non-dormant, able to germinate over the widest possible conditions. So an important point is that even though seeds might be non-dormant, unless the conditions are right, they won't germinate. So over time, many seeds just cycle back into dormancy, and this happens over seasons and over years, and so they're basically trying to match up to when they think that the chances of seed survival is greatest. So Because of this complexity, that is why we often have trouble terminating our native seeds. And I guess a good way to think about it, you know, why seeds are so finely tuned, why it's sometimes hard for us to unpack and break that dormancy, is because a seed's getting its life when it germinates. So many of our seeds can live for long periods in the soil, years or even decades, potentially centuries. Once they commit to germination, there's no going back. So they have to be really sure that they're going to germinate and survive, and they're very finely tuned. And there's many permutations in terms of what sorts of environmental conditions seeds are actually looking for to lose germination, to lose dormancy and germinate. And we spent a lot of time trying to understand these conditions in the soil. We've done a lot of these kinds of experiments. We bury seeds in bags in the soil. We put data loggers in that measure soil temperature and moisture. And we retrieve the seeds at different times of year, and we look at can we germinate them, under what conditions do they germinate, and try to understand what conditions promote dormancy loss and what conditions promote germination. So we kind of come up with models like this. This graph here, it shows, it's just data from our data loggers, and the top graph is just soil temperature, and this is data from Kings Park actually, so you can see a few things. It's over an entire year. The soil temperature in summer varies from 50 or even up to 65, almost 70 degrees. This is about 2 centimetres below the surface as well. So obviously hot in summer, there's quite a difference in the maximum and the minimum temperature. It's fairly self-evident that it gets cooler as we move through the year. You can see kind of the diurnal fluctuations get much narrower as well. I guess another important point to look at is this is the amount of moisture in the seed. So we retrieve the seeds every 2 weeks, I think, in this example, and measure how much moisture was in them. And again, it's fairly self-evident that over summer the seeds are going to be drier. A couple of important points here is that in early autumn, you can see that the amount of moisture in the seeds, you know, spikes up and down, so the seeds are responding to the sporadic rainfall that we get during autumn. They're wetting, they're drying, they're wetting, they're drying. But again, they come up. But what we can break this into is basically segments. So during summer, we have periods of warm and dry. During autumn, it's warm. It's not as warm as summer, but it's still warm. The soil temperatures are still hovering around 30 to 35 degrees. We start to see some of this wetting and drying. As we move into winter, temperatures get cooler. Water availability becomes more consistent. So we got warmer, dry, warmer, wet, wet, dry, warmer, wet. And so these are the kind of things that we try to use to understand and to break down the seeds. So Acanthocarpus warm stratification, it's a nice example, a classic example of seeds that lose dormancy during periods that are warm and moist. So we give the seeds anywhere between 6 to 12 weeks, usually 6 weeks is enough. So you can see this example here. The key is that warm and moist conditions followed by cool and moist. So about 6 weeks at 30 to 35 degrees, and then we move them to about 15 degrees. And so it's that period of warm that breaks dormancy, and then it's that change in temperature to 15 degrees that initiates germination. So herbaceous seeds are a good example of those that respond to this kind of wetting and drying cycle. So a couple of points with them is the picture you might have seen, two pictures, they have minute embryos, really, really small embryos. An example of seeds where the embryos actually have to grow inside the seed before germination becomes possible. So they kind of have a whole, potentially a whole range of conditions that need, one to initiate embryo growth and then two to initiate subsequent germination. But what we do find with herbaceae is that these wetting and drying cycles become important. So this is a fairly complex graph, but we can break it down a little. We've got temperature here, summer, autumn and winter. This line here just indicates how we move the seeds through a succession of different temperatures. So we're moving through summer temperatures, autumn temperatures, winter temperatures. This hashed line here shows us when the seeds are continually wet. So we've got summer, dry, autumn, we dry, we we start to introduce this wet dry cycle. So what that means is that we keep the seeds basically dry for 4 weeks, but every 2 weeks we wet them up for a day, then we re-dry, simulating that kind of autumn rainfall. And you can kind of see that on these clear triangles here, that this wetting and drying cycle greatly enhances their ability to germinate. So they've got to be warm, they've got to be wet and dry, and then they've got to be moved to cool and kept wet. So it's a little bit complicated, but if you think about it in the context of autumn rainfall moving into winter, it starts to make sense. The other thing we see, and we see this commonly with some of these more complex types of seeds, is you kind of get two flushes of germination. So in the first kind of growing season, you get a proportion of seeds germinating, and another proportion again in the second season. So this is probably kind of like a band etching thing for the seeds. So within the population of seeds, there's varying depths of dormancy. So some seeds come in the first season, some wait until the second season, just to kind of spread the risk to help this goes. All right, so. Okay, so I wanted to move on a little bit from dormancy and think about the germination side and some of the other kind of, I guess, unique aspects of germinating in a coastal environment. It's harsh, it's stressful, and there's some unique challenges that the seeds have to deal with in these environments. One of those is salt and saline conditions. So a little bit of data here just to illustrate basically that it is a salty environment, but the amount of salt varies over the year. And you can see this data is just a measure of the salinity in different positions in the dune as we move kind of from the fore dune through to the swales, through to the back dunes. And you can kind of see that in winter, salinity is a little reduced. So it's raining, it's reducing the salinity in the soil. As we move through summer, it becomes much more saline. So you get this kind of cycling of salinity as well. The seeds have to be able to deal with that too. So not only does dormancy need to time their germination to the correct time of year when the seeds are trying to germinate, in this kind of environment, they're trying to deal with salt. And so we did a fair bit of work trying to understand how seeds cope with salt and how well they can germinate in saline conditions. A couple of examples here are two of our common coastal species, Spiridium globulosa and Clostridium nodosa. The Spiridium turns out to be fairly sensitive to salt. Again, there's a lot of data on this graph, but basically we've got exposing seeds to a range of salinity. So seawater is really up here, I think about 600, so a little bit off this scale, but this is just the cumulative percent of germination as seeds are exposed to these different salinities. So a couple of things here, it's not quite showing up too well on this, but basically on this half, on my screen here, this is coloured grey. So what this shows is that whilst the seeds are exposed to salt, some of them can germinate at low concentrations. Then what we do is we move them from salt into water. So this is testing their ability to recover from these saline conditions and subsequently germinate. So over here, this is pure water, this is salt. So you can see with the Spiridium, at low concentrations, in fact, relatively high really compared to seeds that don't grow up close. Some germination is possible. When we move it into water, germination becomes a little bit more possible at these really, so 400 or 500 millimolars, almost no germination moving into water. We get some recovery, but only about half of what happens in water. A more salt tolerant species like Wassini, you can kind of see we get almost full recovery of germination. So it's able to tolerate very high concentrations of salt, sit there and wait, and then subsequently germinate when that salinity is kind of alleviated. And so there's two ways seeds can do that, really. They can either tolerate the salt somehow, or they can exclude it. And so we spent some time looking at that, and I won't go into that in too much detail, but one figure here, this basically shows these two seeds, the Glossinia and the Sporidium, combined in highly saline solution, and how much salt are they taking up. You can see that Glossinia basically isn't taking up any salt, so it's actually able to exclude the salt from the seed, and that is how it's able to recover subsequently in germinate. Whereas Spiridium over time just accumulates more and more and more salt. So if it's exposed to too much salt, eventually that seed's going to die. Recovery's not going to be so good. And when you think about where these plants grow in the dunes, you can start to maybe put this together a little bit, and there's kind of a concept about, you know, an environmental niche. So certain plants are only growing in regions where they're able to survive, and the environment kind of filters for certain plant traits. The same thing happens for seeds, and you know, you get this kind of classic success in vegetation, and this is kind of a simple way of expressing where, you know, distribution of these plant species is going to be from the waterline through to the back dunes. And you can see that Boscinia grows, you know, fairly close to these four dunes, whereas Spiridium only is growing further back there. So you can start to think about, well, maybe the seed traits, the ability of these seeds, Boscinia, to tolerate and germinate in saline conditions is partly dictating their environment. So the last thing I just wanted to talk about to extend that a little bit more is the concept of dispersal and how seeds move around in the landscape and actually arrive at a site where they're potentially able to germinate and survive, which is a key part of, you know, why plants evolve seeds, of course. And there's some really interesting things happening potentially in coastal environments for seeds, and that's you know, many of you will be aware, I'm sure, that the distribution of many coastal plants is broad. This is in effect on the foliage that you can see, kind of really grows around, you know, a large proportion of Australia. These seeds are moving very long distances probably to allow this plant to disperse over such a large distance. This is pretty common for many of our coastal species, hundreds or even thousands of kilometres of range, which is not perhaps seen so much for species that are not in these coastal environments. And the interesting thing about the coastal environment is kind of illustrated in this picture, and that's that we have the ocean and a potential means of dispersal, and we call that hydrochoria. So this is, you know, kind of the classic example of, you know, the coconut floating around between islands and the plant dispersing between islands. And so, you know, we were thinking about that concept also with our coastal seas and thinking about, well, you know, how might seas contribute to dispersal of these plants by the ocean? A couple of obvious questions: can the seeds float? So here's some nice experiments looking at the ability of different types of coastal seeds to float. This is in the laboratory. It's pretty hard to throw seeds in the ocean and find out where they end up. So it is an experiment, but it demonstrates the fact that seeds can float in seawater potentially for quite some time. So, you know, and we're looking at different types of seeds and, you know, how their morphology, etc., might contribute to how well they can float. A range of responses. The take-home message is that many seeds can float for 20, 30, 40 days or more. And out of 10 species that we looked at, 9 of them survive for long periods of time just sitting in seawater. So a little bit like the germination experiment I was showing you earlier, we were just basically imbibing floating seeds in seawater. And you can see, for example, for Rogodia, that can survive quite happily and germinate even up to sitting for 70 days in seawater. The only one we saw a real decline in germination was with Conostylis canicum. So 9 out of 10 common coastal species we looked at had a similar kind of response to this, up to 70 days in seawater, germinate, no problem. So just to wrap it up and finish up here, I guess hopefully I've given you a little bit of a sense of some of the adaptation of our coastal seeds and really putting this all together. If we're thinking about how they might disperse through the landscape, many of them might blow into the water, might be carried by a bird into the water, they'll float, they'll survive floating around, they'll land at a site, dormancy will control when they germinate, they're then able to tolerate these saline conditions as they come and get going. So, sorry for a few technical difficulties there, but I think we got through okay. I'd just like to finish with some acknowledgements real quick, particularly Lydia Guia, who was a PhD student with us at Kings Park and Curtin, Kingsley Grant and myself, and did a lot of this work, in fact, really all of the work regarding salt tolerance, dispersal, etc. And then Shane and Jeff and Sydney, a lot of work over many years with unpacking dormancy. So thanks very much for your attention. Thank you.
Thank you.
Just time for one question while we're loading up the next talk.
One thing we didn't touch on was pH.
We've found in the last couple of years, the local government planted alocasia arenas and, I'll call them leaves, sort of all dropping on the ground and everything. We can't regenerate anything in those areas.
Mm-hmm.
Particularly the Carpa rubus all died off this year, wherever the needles
fell. Yeah, from seed or from, at seedlings.
Well, I mean, the
Carpa
rubus was years old and it's just all died. So how quickly does the pH change and it kind of is that effective that it just stops everything growing within a year?
It's a good question. I mean, we've looked at pH in the coastal system and, you know, it changes again. It's obviously much more alkaline for the foregene and gets less alkaline as you move back. I guess the only thing I can say maybe is most plants like it between 5.5 and 6.5. Our coastal species are a little bit more adapted to more alkaline environments. But I guess once you get above maybe 8 or 8.5, you know, things will be struggling.
We've just been told the allocation arena is probably what's changing the pH. I don't know whether it's sort of somebody's guess or.
I think it makes it more acidic actually.
That's correct.
Mm. Yeah, that's what we're
Yeah.
So that could be an issue there.
Can I just
raise
the issue again about
the carpet brochures? This is going to be for every talk.
It's something that's the practical application.
Yes.
But some people have identified what they are confident is the correct carpet brochure for an area.
Mm-hmm.
And they're using cuttings or propagation methods. At that time, it seems that it's really important to supply both male and female plants, otherwise you're just heading for disaster long term. And I'd just like to see a comment from people who are familiar with that, if that's been done, or if it's not been done, when will it be done?
Well, I think your answer to the question is just what's been done, and you have a good proportion of plant with me.
So I think that sort of needs to be more publicised.
Yeah.
Good, thank you very much, George.